All right, welcome back to Third Line Grind. Chris Caravelli here with Hagen Demzik and Grady Little. Sorry, Grady, you got the third spot on that one.
It's all right.
We're here today with Alex Limoges.
Hey, guys, thanks for having me.
Yeah, thanks for being here. Alex is a native Virginian. He's from Winchester. He's a former student and player of mine in his youth career. And he's a current NCAA D1 player. We'll get into that a little bit later. Let's start with your youth hockey days, Alex. How'd you get interested in playing hockey?
I got interested when I was pretty young. I'd say I started skating when I was 2 years old. I used to go to my dad's men's league games and wheel around out there before the ZAM came on. So maybe, I don't know, 4 or 5 minutes at a time. But slowly, you know, I fell in love with the game and you know, the rest is history.
Watching your dad play men's league, let's go back to that for a second. Did he have a background playing hockey? Is that something that he passed on to you, or was it just strictly for him a recreational hobby to go out and get some exercise, hang out with his buddies, and do whatever?
Well, he's French-Canadian, so we always say it's in the blood.
Yep.
But he grew up playing hockey as well as some other sports, but actually made it over to Germany and played in the second league there. So,
Nice.
Pro hockey, and you know, I kind of learned from him.
I didn't know that about your dad.
Yeah,
that's cool.
I knew that about his dad. He told me one time.
Yeah.
I said, oh, yeah, I played over in Germany. I was like, oh, cool.
Nice.
Yeah. Back when we were coaching Logan.
Yeah, really?
Yeah.
For those that don't know, Logan is the younger brother of Alex, and Hagen and I both coached Logan a couple of years ago when he was smaller than both of us. He's a lot bigger now. So going back to your youth career, where did you play growing up and what position did you play?
Yeah, in Virginia, I grew up and played for Ashburn a little bit. And then when Little Caps was, you know, when I was old enough to play Little Caps, and I played there for the next 5 years. So it was a lot of travel, especially coming from Winchester, but I always played either left wing or center or right wing. I don't know. Wherever they needed me up front, it didn't really matter as long as I could be out there.
What were some of your big influences as far as coaches, NHL players, guys you looked up to?
Yeah, like I was saying, my dad was a huge influence. And it's always on me, motivating me and you know, to work out with him or you know, do little extra things off the ice here and there. Other than that, my favorite player growing up was Joe Sakic. So nice. I was born in Colorado. Yeah.
You know. Are you guys going to throw down now? Because Chris being a Red Wings fan, I'm going to bet there's an allegiance to Steve Yzerman there.
I mean, I was a Steve Yzerman fan too.
I'm a fan of one of the greatest rivalries, though.
Yeah, I mean, both Detroit and Colorado, when they played
mid 90s,
that was the best hockey to watch.
Absolutely.
The best hockey to watch. It could be like the first week of the season.
Oh, yeah.
And it's like playoff hockey.
Yeah,
it was the best.
On the ice. Yeah.
Absolutely. Forsberg.
It's an absolute yard
sale. It's so many players.
Some studs out
there. I mean, Datsyuk, Fedorov, Lidstrom.
Yeah, the
McCarthy, Moltke.
Russian five was
Osgood.
I don't think it gets much better than that.
Dude, that was sick.
Surprisingly enough, I was a big fan of both Sakic and Yzerman, even being a Red Wings fan, just because Sakic was such a good player.
But I'd say it's almost comparable to the Crosby-Ovechkin comparables there, because
it's pretty
think
close.
About it, yeah, you have two captains, two leaders of their organizations, and two heated rivals. So just take this back 20 years, and then I think you have Yzerman and Sakic.
Yeah, I was just going to say that, especially I don't know. If you ask Pittsburgh people, I don't think they like Ovechkin as much. But I think around here, it's like, oh, both guys are great players. It doesn't really matter.
Right.
But,
right. You have to – you might not like him, but you have to respect the talent
exactly.
that's on both sides there.
Well, the one thing about Sakic and Yzerman I always found when I was watching when I was younger, I felt like, you know, so like you compare Crosby and Ovechkin, right?
Yep.
You know, Ovechkin is just a sheer goal scorer.
Yep.
Like, he'll get assists, don't get me wrong, but he is a sheer shooter. Like, he's a goal scorer, goal scoring machine. Crosby can score, but he's also, like, a playmaker. He's got, like, a kind of a different style.
What?
I felt like Sakic and Yzerman at certain times were almost, like, the identical player.
Yeah.
Like, they're so similar to each other.
They approach the game very similar.
Very similar. You know, the face-offs, the way they shot, the way they skated, you know, I felt like they're so similar skill set-wise and kind of both provided the same thing for their team.
Yeah, and the game was different back then. The game was a lot more physical, a lot more gritty in the corner, stuff like that. So they had a lot more of that element to their game. But if you kind of take that, you know, the Crosby element of being able to control the game in the offensive zone, being able to find the open man, being able to create offense, I think they have a lot of those comparables just added add in a little bit of that sandpaper finish on them. And then you got Eisen and Sackett right there.
Sandpaper finish, I love it.
Alex, in your youth playing days, what did you like most about the coaches you had? What did you like the least?
Chris Cabrelli.
I knew it was coming.
Yeah, you said yourself was coming. Up, walked right into that one.
It was coming. You liked me the least, maybe.
No, no. I especially playing for Little Caps, I think even at the time with Ashburn, each year the coaches were good at different skills. You know, one year, whether it be edges, power skating, and then another year kind of with the hands and seeing the game. It was interesting to see how they built on top of each other. And I really feel that's where my game progressed and where I was able to, I don't know, kind of complete it. Obviously, there's still things I need to work on. There's still things that I needed coming out of those years to get to the next level. But they really laid the foundation. So I think that's what I liked about it best. It kind of each year they just got better and better. The least, I don't know. I don't think there's anything really about the coaches or anything. I think it was just the travel. Hour and a half each way to practice three times a week, and then games were the most southern team. So we always, you know, hour and a half was a home game.
Yep.
That was the hardest part. It wasn't, I mean, especially on my parents, I got to sleep in the car and do homework and stuff like that. That's growing up with hockey in Winchester, Virginia.
Yeah, but that takes a lot of discipline to be able to maintain your academics while maintaining that schedule. Like you said, driving 3 hours round trip for, you know, being on the ice an hour and a half, and you're going to get to practice a solid 45 minutes an hour early. So that's a long time that you're spending away from home after school, and you're still able to maintain your grades. Was that a difficult thing to do? Like, did you struggle? Did you see your grades slip?
No. I mean, I love it so much, so yeah. It made it worth it. And, you know, I would normally sleep on the way to practice and then do homework the whole way back.
Yep.
It was good. It taught me discipline and, you know, how important a routine is.
Right.
So it was kind of like automatic. You know, my dad never asked me to or got on me to finish my homework or do stuff like that. It's just kind of, I knew that I'm going to have an hour and a half to do my homework here and get it all done.
Right. So. And so we'll jump into your college career a little bit more later, but would you say that, you know, being able to have that discipline instilled in you at such a young age that it helps you with being a collegiate athlete now on how to study and prepare to make sure that you're both going to excel in the classroom and on the ice?
Absolutely. And another thing that helped me build that was I actually went to boarding school for sophomore and junior year. I guess you can count that as youth hockey.
Yep.
And so that made it a lot better with hockey and school kind of working out of the same place. And so that really helped me get ready for juniors in college.
Yep.
It was important to me. And I think it's a huge part of who I am today.
I think it's a good point that you even bring up, you know, how much you enjoyed school and that kind of stuff. Cause you know, that's, you know, one of the biggest things I think for kids that want to play D1 is, you know, you're sometimes the athlete, but sometimes you're not the student athlete, which is what, you know, to get to the D1 level, you need to not only be an athlete, but you need to be a good student as well to be able to keep progressing through the years and that kind of stuff. And I think that's a good thing to kind of point out to the kids and stuff, the dedication to school and having that routine and just, hey, I got my practice. I have an hour and a half of homework I got to do, and just kind of sticking to it the whole time for the youth players is good.
And I find a lot of tendencies are similar and transition pretty seamlessly from on ice to off ice studies. So I think for everybody listening, that's a big part of progressing in hockey is to make sure you keep up on your schoolwork. And
it's kind of like acting. It's professional.
Yeah,
exactly. You know, if you want to be a professional, you got to take everything, every aspect of your life needs to be run professionally.
Yeah.
And you need to take pride in it and really strive to work hard. So that's good.
Well, I'm glad you brought that up, being professional. We talked about that a little bit last week with Adam Conrad. But we asked him, what does it mean to be a professional? Because we were talking about the Brandon Lipsick situation. And Adam brought up the point that you just need to be a professional all the time. You have to realize that you're lucky to play a game for a living. And you're making money doing it, so you got to be professional in every sense of the way. But for you, what does it mean to be a professional on the ice, off the ice?
It's just taking pride in the stuff you do and yourself and representing the team and your family. You know, it's very easy to – I think it's very easy to be a professional if you're you're dedicated and you stay on top of all your stuff. Yep. Otherwise, you know, one slip up can cost you everything. So it's a fine line that you're walking on, but being a professional is, it takes a lot of work. But if you love it, then it's pretty easy.
Yeah. Makes a lot of sense.
Well, if you love it, it's not considered work anymore.
Exactly. Yeah. Yeah. Right.
It's part of your lifestyle. It's what you choose to live. So
Alex, give us a little bit of background on your junior hockey career. Where did you play junior hockey?
I played junior hockey for the Tri-City Storm in the USHL. I got passed over a few times in the draft, a couple of years. So third time's a charm, and I got picked up by them. And lucky to have, we won the championship that first year. And it's
sometimes better to get passed up in the championship.
Right. Oh, yeah. I'd do anything to win. that was one of the highlights of my career for sure. So then next year, I decided to go back and take a gap year between high school and college and just focus on the hockey and really do everything I could to maximize this opportunity. So I went back and was the assistant captain and then named captain about a quarter way through the year of Tri-City Storm. And then things were not working out as we had planned. So I was traded at close to the deadline to Waterloo Blackhawks, where we made another run at the Cup. I made a lot of great friendships and memories that, you know, I still talk to the guys today and compete against them. So junior hockey overall was just a great experience.
So how do you feel, I guess, going from AAA hockey to junior A hockey? What was that transition like? What did you learn from junior A that you didn't learn from AAA?
I learned the business aspect of hockey. It's crazy, you know, going from AAA where the coach can't cut you. I mean, pretty much throughout the year, you feel safe.
Yeah. They could bench you, but they really can't. They can't just kick you off the team.
Exactly.
Or trade you.
Yeah. Yeah. So that's what the big thing about junior hockey is, the business. You know, you can't be satisfied. Otherwise, you know, one day you're gone. There's plenty of kids that want to be in that spot. And if you're not doing it, I know somebody else will. So that was – which made the jump a little hard, you know. My first year going there with – there's 40 kids showing up at
– main camp?
A bunch of kids at main camp. And then when they cut down, there's 30, 35, I don't know, that show up to Kearney, Nebraska there. And it's like, all right, you know, I'm this new kid. All these guys are older and stronger. And, like, how am I going to fit in here, you know? Am I going to get cut? I can't go back to high school, or you really got to make the most of your opportunity. But
so when you transitioned to playing junior hockey for Tri-City, your first season, you guys won a championship. How much ice time did you have during the season? Did you play every game? Did you have games where your coach would sit you out, or how'd that go?
It was an interesting roller coaster ride my first year. Started out, I was on first, second line, center, and this is the first time in a lot of years that I was playing center. So, first game, I had two assists in the first period, and I was like, "Oh my gosh, this could be great."
You're thinking this is gonna be easy, right?
Yeah, and then later, come to find out, one of the assists wasn't mine. So I was like, "Okay, all right, that's fine." But it's okay. I had confidence for a nice 20 minutes, and then 7 games into the season, I broke my wrist, which was obviously tough. I missed the next 17 games or the next 2 months. But it was interesting because at that time, the 7 games, I kind of got complacent and found myself, you know, not doing as well as I should. So the next 2 months, I really took a time to get stronger, get faster. And when I came back, I was put right in with my line mates for the rest of the year, which was kind of first or second line center there. And from that moment on, we tore it up and we didn't look back. And I don't know our record when I came back. I'm not saying that I helped that
much. Oh, okay. All right.
Humble brag.
Everything took off, you know. My line mates started taking off. And so and it was an unbelievable year.
That's awesome.
Yeah. So after after making a USHL team, how'd that shape your decision in playing D1 hockey? Take us through that.
Yeah, that's a good question. Honestly, once I made the team and you know, was playing consistently and stuff like that, it just gave me a lot of confidence going into college. I know it's another step up, but all of my peers at the junior level are going to D1 colleges. And, you know, personally, I felt like I was among the top, top 20% of the league. So I was like, okay, these guys are all going to be playing in college next year. I think that if they can do it, I can do it.
So, there's a really large percentage of players that play in the USHL that move on to some type of either D1 or D3 school, right?
Exactly.
Playing hockey there. So
yeah.
Did that? You feel like that gave you a little bit of confidence when you're playing consistently? Okay, I can at least play D1 or D3 mm-hmm. hockey.
Yeah. And at the time, I had committed to Cornell University when I was a junior in high school. So my whole time in that first year in the USHL and half the second year, I was committed to Cornell.
Cornell was pretty highly ranked at that point, right?
Yeah, they were. They were top 10 in the country, and they've been top 10 in the country ever since, top 5 in the country. So it's cool to see them have success, but it didn't work out. And so then, I was a veteran in the league and went that second year after Christmas uncommitted, and the phone started ringing a lot. And so that gave me a lot of confidence too. It's interesting. Not many people are put in that position where you can't really go wrong picking a university. So,
it's a nice place to be.
Yeah, that's for sure. But a lot of led up to that, and I think the USHL had a big thing.
So, if you're comfortable doing so, who were some of, or what were some of the schools that were calling you, and what sort of solidified your position in going to Penn State?
Yeah. I narrowed it down to 4 teams.
Yeah.
So I took official visits at Penn State, obviously, Maine, Denver, and Duluth. So all unbelievable schools, hockey-wise and academic-wise. And it's funny because when I went to Penn State, I fell in love with it. You know, it's the closest school to home, 3 hours away. It's the closest I would be in the past 4 years to my family. That meant a lot to them, but it meant a lot to me. Like Big Ten school facility was just second to none.
The rink there is
atmosphere.
Insane.
Oh, yeah, my God, yeah.
It's super nice.
You know, I play hockey in paradise every day. So I can't imagine going anywhere else. But then it was funny because that year Denver beat Penn State in the national tournament and went on to win the national championship. And then the year after that, Minnesota Duluth won it.
So we know Cornell was up this year.
Right, exactly.
No, Maine's up next year.
I think
Maine's up next year.
Penn State is close, though, that's for sure.
Absolutely. You guys are definitely leadership now.
You guys are definitely an exciting team to watch.
Yeah.
For sure. You guys, the way the style of Penn State plays, I love watching the home games and that kind of stuff. It just seems you guys have a good fan base, the facility, and just in general, the style.
Yeah.
I think you guys are definitely a fun team to watch.
Hungry, aggressive game, it seems like.
Exactly. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It's very like aggressive. Going a million miles an hour for a short amount of time for each shift, but that adds up over the game. And then with the atmosphere there, and we love to shoot, love to score goals, so it's a lot of fun playing hockey for Penn State. Yeah.
How much does the home rink atmosphere play into your team's psyche when you're there versus if you're at another Big Ten school mm-hmm. playing a game? What's the difference between playing at home and playing away?
Yeah, student section is got to be the biggest thing. I have good relationships with everybody else in the league, especially like the goalies and stuff. Somehow there's just a mutual respect there. But no, they always say it's so hard to play. Our student section is right behind.
Right behind the goalie, right?
The goalie, and it's the steepest incline that the state would allow. So that's how they built
pack
it.
As many people as possible.
Exactly. That's and awesome. So everybody's sitting right on top of them. And the rest of the crowd, the town loves coming out and showing support. And everybody's so loud and into it. It's really a special atmosphere.
That's going to be a special feeling when you put one home too, huh?
Oh, yeah, definitely. Yeah, there's nothing like
yeah,
it.
Yeah, right? I'd imagine like there's a smile on your face after you're in the middle of a game too, so you don't want to look too hard.
Oh,
but
no,
I can imagine that when you score a goal and you hear that crowd erupt, that, I mean, it's got to be an unreal feeling.
Well, that's the thing. I get too excited and I don't know how to celebrate. I throw my hands up. There's many clips of me just falling down right after I score a goal because I don't know what to do. Also, with that big smile you were talking about, I always have it on.
Yeah,
but the problem
is,
I have a mouth guard going over the cage, so pictures that are taken of me smiling, it just looks like I have a black hole in my mouth. I've been 3 years of me asking for a white mouth guard, and now maybe my last year I can have
maybe they'll get you
that.
One for the new captain. For those that don't know, Alex was just named captain of the 2020-2021 season. So congratulations on that.
Thank you very much.
That's awesome.
That's real quick, if we stay on that for a second, how does that news come down to you? You get a coach or a call from your coach saying, hey, we appreciate what you've done so far. We know that you possess all these leadership qualities. How does that go?
Yeah. So at the end of the year, we fill out kind of team evaluations and individuals and, what players had these kind of characteristics. And then ultimately it ends with who should be captain for the next year.
Right.
So then just a couple of weeks went by after filling that out, and then we had exit meetings through FaceTime with our coach, and he brought it up and he said, your teammates and the coaches think, believe in you, and we know that you can lead this team in the right direction. And so I was speechless. I didn't know what to say, and still really don't. It kind of hasn't hit me until I think I get there, but it's very cool. I've always wanted to be the captain
of course.
Penn State.
It's interesting that you say that it was a surprise. I feel like a lot of I feel like there's a lot of players that maybe expect it or know that they're going to get that. Do you have any inkling that you would be considered for a captaincy, or you're just too humble?
I think
it's something you wanted, just not.
Yeah, exactly. I definitely wanted it, but the assistant captains have been captains, where they were before, and Arni Talvitie was captain of Finland at the World Juniors when they won it.
Wow.
So that's a great player too. And
some
then
leadership there too.
Alden Naples captained Sioux Falls Stampede in the USHL, and I don't know. I felt there was a couple good picks, but. But it's something that I've wanted since freshman year. And even though I didn't have a letter last year or the year before that, I felt like I was in a leadership role where through my play, people would listen to me and stuff like that. So I think being humble is a big part of why I got it. Just got to put my head down and work.
Well, that's a big point that you bring up there. You have your captains, you have your assistant captains, but there's obviously other players on the team that can have a leadership role. And it's the way you carry yourself on and off the ice, by your play style, your work ethic. You got a guy that's hardworking. He might not have a C or an A on his jersey, but kind of his play and the way his demeanor about him kind of is a leadership role to the rest of the team as well.
Exactly.
So that's a big point to bring up. You don't always have to have the C or the A on your jersey to be a leader on your team.
That's a really good point, Hagen. And I think, I know personally, I see it in youth hockey all the time, where at the beginning of the season especially, you'll have all the kids gathering around the net to pick up pucks, clean up the water bottles, all that stuff. And then as soon as you name captains and all that stops, then you're doing it by yourself at that point. But I think that's a great point to make and a great lesson for the youth to learn.
Yeah, I agree. I think that if you look in the NHL, like there's a ton of great players in the NHL that are leaders that don't necessarily have a letter on their jersey, like you're saying.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot you can bring a lot to the game even if you don't have that letter on your shirt.
Absolutely.
But Alex, we're glad you got one.
Yeah, me too. Thank you.
I think Backstrom's like that, right? They give him the A
final.
Yeah, yeah. But I remember in the beginning he did that.
Like you look at somebody like TJ Oshie.
Yeah.
TJ Oshie is somebody that has a lot of veteran experience. He's been around the league forever. He works hard, and he's got
a lot of respect.
So.
It's also just an absolute beauty.
Yeah,
that as well. But
so in terms of this season and how it ended, you said you had some exit meetings with your coaches and whatnot. how did you learn that your season was not going to continue this year? And then just kind of take us through that a little bit.
Yeah, obviously devastating news. We put ourselves in a really good position to win the Big Ten tournament and win the national championship, honestly. We felt like we had the team to do it. We had just won Big Ten regular season for the first time in Penn State history. So we had an off week, or we had two bye weeks, and we were putting in a lot of work. And I guess this was over spring break time, and all this stuff was breaking. And so we were called in. Nobody knows what's going on. And it was like, all right, guys, this is where we're at right now. Things are not looking good. Harvard just canceled their season. And a few other teams in those leagues started to do the same. Big Ten was the last to do so. So we were holding out, and then 12 hours later, we get another text and say, all right, guys, another team meeting tomorrow morning. And so we were brought in, given the news. Coach, like, didn't say so in the beginning. He just had this heartfelt speech and was tearing up. And so it's everybody knew, kind of pit drop in the stomach. So.
Yeah. That's tough as a coach when you have, I'm sure, especially at your level, right? And you have so many great players and you have such a great season and a really good run, and then it just gets lopped off.
Right.
So yeah. It's a tough thing to have happen.
You see those kids work so hard, right? Yeah. So long. It's not, practices almost start, captain practices start close to as soon as you get to school, right?
Yeah.
So that's August, September, and then we're still talking about March now. So you guys been going for that long, putting all that work to just have it cut short. And, I can understand completely how your coach would get teary-eyed.
Right.
And you said that you got the text and you had a team meeting, the next morning. Did you guys kind of already know after you got that text?
Yeah.
What was coming?
Oh, absolutely. So as soon as we got that text, I won't go into detail, but we all got together and kind of had one last send off as a team. So
self-medication, right?
It's yeah, good. Exactly.
It's good to have this. It's good. It's where some of your best memories come from.
That's
it's
true.
It's team bonding. Or lack thereof.
Yeah.
It's team bonding.
So now that your season's over, your coaches, obviously, they just made the captain. They know you're coming back next year. Do you have anybody that's reaching out to you that's sort of advising you on what you need to do off the ice? If you have the opportunity on the ice, what do you do?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I have a lot of good guys in my corner. Giving advice, and I'm pretty proactive with asking them what could I be doing right now? Obviously, school ended a couple weeks ago, and so now I don't have to worry about finals or anything like that. I kind of
nice.
Yeah, it's nice. I'm in a good routine. I wake up early in the morning and work out while it's still cold outside, and then kind of active the rest of the day. But doing these home workouts, I have specific things that I'm working on, whether it's just building strength and explosiveness, and then starting to work on a lot of different stick handling things in the basement, as well as shooting off both feet. That's one thing I look to be better at this next year, is working and shooting a lot more. There's a lot of things that I could be doing, but right now I'm focusing on kind of those specific ones.
It's really honing in on what you felt like are some weaknesses in your game, trying to make those more of a strength.
Yeah, exactly. Because I don't know how everybody's doing or what they're doing during this time, but I know that next year is going to be a big year for a lot of reasons. So I want to be the best that I can be showing up after school.
Yeah. Well, and you've put so much work in, right, through your through your whole hockey life.
Mm-hmm.
You put all this work in. You don't want to be lazy for a couple months or 6 months here or something like that, right? And then all of a sudden you lose your opportunity, or you go back to school, and then Alex hasn't done anything in the off season and he's not in shape, and he's not the leader we're looking for, and then they're going to take that C away. So it's great to get to that point, right? Once you get there, you got to work almost twice as hard to keep
exactly.
it. It's good to see that you're committed to that.
Absolutely, and there's a lot of motivation too. I want to win the Big Ten championship. I want to win a national championship. I want to lead the team the right way. So I want to play pro hockey. And it's a lot of things that keep me going. And you know, I enjoy working out too, so it's not a hardship on me right now.
Yeah, I think once you get in that routine, once you're stuck in the routine, it's easy to keep it. Right?
Like, that's it.
Just you wake up and like, okay, all right, I gotta go work out. Let's go to the heart.
I remember only 3 days to break a routine. You guys have heard that before, right? Yep. Take something like 33 days to set a routine, 3 days to break it. So, and for you guys listening, that means that
no days off.
If you're trying to set a routine or a habit for yourself, it really takes 33 days of doing said activity disciplined to become a habit of yours. But it only takes 3 days if you go without, if we're talking about working out, skating, whatever it is, you take 3 days consecutively off, then that's going to completely deprive you of that habit you built, and you're going to be back at square one trying to get started again.
Alex, you talked a little bit about pro hockey. Do you have aspirations of playing pro hockey?
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
Oh, yeah.
So if you could pick any team in the NHL, where would you go?
Loaded question.
Yeah, no, exactly.
Because we know all the NHL execs are listening to this one.
I get asked that quite a bit.
Yeah. You can give us the political answer or the real answer. We'll take
Well, I'll give you both.
Now we're talking.
No, any team that wants me.
There it is.
You know, I'll play anywhere that I can play.
I think there's a lot of people that feel that way.
Beggars can't be choosers.
That's for sure.
Otherwise, I was thinking it on the car ride up here. It's like, well, you know, I've grown up here. I've fell in love with the Caps. I was there at their Stanley Cup parade. You know, I think it'd be very cool to be hometown kid playing for the Caps one day. Kind of like Joe Snively.
Just like
Snively,
yeah.
Exactly.
Did you play with Snively? He's older than
me. Yeah, he's 1 year older than me.
Okay.
But we know each other. We talk a lot.
Yeah.
And, so I think that'd be pretty cool.
Yeah, it'd be awesome.
Yeah, especially, you know, hockey in Virginia is growing. So I think that'd give a lot of the kids some hope, too.
For sure. It's good to see guys like Snively go pro and have a career with Hershey. And, you know, they feed right into the Caps.
Right.
I was at a preseason game this season where he's suited up. So it was cool to see.
Hopefully that's you next year.
It's cool as a coach to see
you next summer.
It's neat to see kids that you've coached actually get to that point in their career.
Right.
It's really cool.
And you tell yourself it's all the coaching.
It's all the coaching.
Oh, yeah. I taught them that.
Right.
See that?
It's 100 different coaches.
See that? Tried the shot. It's all me.
So for some of the players that are in the NHL right now, who do you feel like your game resembles the most?
Yeah. So I try to resemble my game after Nicklas Backstrom. I've been told over the past couple of years that I kind of remind people of like a Nick Bonino or John Tavares. So a lot of guys last year said that I play a lot like John Tavares. So
it's not bad.
That's a great compliment. Absolutely, he's an unbelievable player, and I watched a lot of Toronto's games this past year.
Yeah,
just because how exciting of a team they are to watch, and it was cool to see, kind of listen to what they're telling me, and then see him actually do it. It's like, all right, you know, maybe I can try that in practice or something like that.
Yeah. Well, and you tend to work pretty closely around the net, right?
Mm-hmm.
Like kind of inside the hash marks to the net. Tavares is very similar to that. It's kind of his bread and butter.
Oh, yeah.
Low puck protection and then driving the net. So,
very cool. Yeah, quick hands, guys, and stick in.
If you could play on a line with any two forwards in the NHL, who would it be?
I was thinking about this last night, too. I never even contemplated that, but I would say probably Nathan MacKinnon and
a lot of speed.
Yeah.
Wicked shot.
Give him the puck and Austin Matthews.
Okay. I knew it. I had a feeling you were going to pick that. So that'd be a crazy line right there.
To
have that speed still all in one line.
Well, you know what? I'll give them the puck and I'll stand in front of them.
Yeah, right?
I don't think it changes.
Just chisel points from
them? Yeah. I don't think it changes too much my game right now. Chip the puck, let a fast winger take it. I mean, they're both centermen, but let somebody take it, and then I'll just go park in front of the net, and if it hits off me or whatever. Right.
Steal their goal. Man.
Yeah, right?
I don't know. They passed pretty well. They probably just put your stick on the ice.
They did. Exactly. It's perfect.
That spinorama pass that Matthews had this year was unreal.
Yeah.
I loved it ever since they put Marner and Matthews together.
Oh, yeah.
It's just much more fun of a line to watch. Like, they're just... They're awesome together.
Especially, yeah, I had both those guys on my fantasy team too. So,
so fingers crossed.
Yeah,
keep them together.
Oh my god, every power play notification is like, all right, change the channel. We're going. I need these points. But
that's awesome,
Dad.
You guys have anything else for Alex?
I think that's it.
Cool, Alex. Thanks a lot for being here. Really appreciate your time, and wish you the best of luck.
Thanks so much. I had a lot of fun.